everybody. My name is Christopher Haddock. I am the director of the show that you're about to see tonight. The hilarious comedy, Charley's Aunt. But first, let's get rid of some business. Welcome to Victorian Players, I did that. Silent cell phones and no texting, because our actors get very distracted. We'll have 2 10-minute intermissions. And during those intermissions, you can use the restrooms downstairs, enjoy the refreshments at the back of the house. Donations to keep the refreshments self-sustaining are welcome. I know, it sounds like we're trying to get money out of you. And you know what? We kind of are. Because there's a special thing I'd like to talk about. We're trying to put in a wheelchair ramp so that more people can get up to the theater. You've all walked up the stairs tonight, right?
No.
I'm in the back entrance.
How'd you do that?
And it's a hassle. We'd like to really get that wheelchair ramp. If you can donate anything. There's a box in the back counter. Has a little ribbon in it. And if you can donate more, that you'd like to make it a tax thing, there are forms and lots of nice people back there that will help you do that. So much for business, okay? Let's see. Raffle tickets. 50-50 raffle tickets, and the raffle for the basket. The basket is filled with all kinds of things from Brazil, because Charley's Aunt, from Brazil, where the nuts come from. Anybody say that with me? From Brazil, where the nuts come from. Good. You're now in on a running gag. Okay? Raffle tickets. This is the official blurb that I was told to say for to set the situation up in case y'all didn't know that, like, this is old times and old people and stuff. And it's very well written, so I'm going to read it word for word for you. Now a word about the play you're about to see. Although this Victorian play speaks to us still, the key to the plot lies in a feature of Victorian morality, which we've been freed ourselves, so it requires explanation, especially in college. Gentlemen did not entertain ladies in their room without an escort. You just don't do that. It's bad. And that's why the boys in the play come up with this great solution. And for that great solution, we'd like you to sit down, relax, let's tell you the story of Charley's Aunt.
I don't know what to say. I wish to goodness I'd spoken to her at the dance the other evening when she told me they were all going away for the summer. Instead, I've waited until the very last minute and I'm regularly nonplussed. By George, I know what I'll do. I'll write up a letter a dozen different ways and send the one that looks the best. So here we are, Jack, in love with the dearest girl in the world. Tackle her like a man and tell her so, or she'll be off the door and you'll be gone now and you'll lose all your chance forever. She's my fate and I'm hanged if I shan't be hers. So here goes. My darling. Rather strong, perhaps, to begin with. My dear Miss Vernon. No, too formal. Not at all how I really feel. My dear... Oh, hang it, why not? My dear Kitty. Now that's grand. Now I'm going to head to the house on fire. My dear Kitty...
I beg your pardon, sir, but would you mind?
Yes, very much. Go away. I'm busy.
Oh, yes, sir, but...
I'm busy with the most important affair. Get out.
Yes, sir.
Just as I made such a good start, too. My dear Kitty... What are you doing, Brass? I confound it all what you want.
I merely wish to say, sir, that I have laid out a few things.
All right, thank you. Now leave me alone.
Which I thought you wouldn't care to...
Take them, keep them, take every blessed rag I've got. Only get out and leave me alone. My dear Kitty...
I beg your pardon, sir.
Confound it all, Brass, that I was not addressing you. Get out! my dear Kitty.
Oh, I say.
I swear, Brass, if you don't get out, I... Oh, it's you, Charlie. What is it, old chap?
Nothing, Jack. I don't want to bother you if you're busy.
Don't mind me today. Come to that fool, Brass.
What's he doing?
Only bagging all my clothes because I'm going down and worrying at the old Perry while I'm trying to write a most important letter. If you don't mind me today, I'm nervous and nagging and nonplussed.
And so am I, Jack.
Why?
Well, I'm trying to write a letter, too.
A letter? To whom?
To Miss Fettigew.
Well, how far have you got?
Oh, I began awfully well, but I didn't want to seem too distant, and I didn't like to be too,
familiar? Well?
Well, so I just said, my dear Amy. And then words failed me. So I've come to you for advice. You always know just what to say and do.
Do I?
Oh, you know my idiot complaint. I'm shy, you're not.
Aren't I?
So prescribe for me, old chap. What am I to say?
A brilliant idea. I'll prescribe and you and take the medicine myself. All right, so let's see. You're in love with Amy Spectrum, and you want to see if she feels the same way, and if so...
Well, you see, they're off to Scotland tomorrow.
Yes, I know. And you want to see her? When, where, bear wait. Do I diagnose the case correctly?
To a T, old chap.
All right, so you want to start with something such as... My dear Kitty...
No, not Kitty, Amy.
Yes, of course. What was I thinking? My dearest Amy. Forgive me, darling, for thus addressing you, but I love you so deeply, underlined.
Rather strong.
Shut up! So earnestly, also underlined,
I say,
that I must write and tell you so. All I ask is...
Well, there's only one obstacle of my putting it quite as straight as that, as much as I'd like to.
Well, what is it?
Well, I've an aunt.
My dear Charlie, most of us have. What of her?
Well, I feel I ought to tell her first.
If you're going to drag an aunt into business, you might as well wait till they come back from Scotland.
Why?
You know what auntie is when she steps in.
Well, no, I don't. That's just it. I don't know her. I've never even seen her.
Well, you mustn't be too hard on this aunt. She hasn't interfered much in your business up to now.
Except to find out that I was an orphan, and have me sent to Oxford and to Eton. And now my guardian writes to tell me that she's to come here this morning by an early train and take luncheon with me at 1 o'clock.
And you've never seen her?
No, she went off to Brazil before I was born to become a sort of secretary to a very rich old Brazilian chap out there called Don Pedro Dalvadores. And by the merest accident in the world, I've seen this.
Madam, or rather Don Lucia Dalvadores, the Brazilian millionaire, who has taken Lord Topley's magnificent mansion in Belgravia, is an English woman of genial disposition and a financial genius. Indeed, it was her capacity in this direction that earned her the gratitude of her late husband, and led to a romantic deathbed marriage. Well, I don't see much in that.
Go on, Jack, read the next.
Her only relation is a nephew at Oxford. Lucky nephew.
Yes, that's me.
By George, Thomas is a startler, and she may be here any minute.
I wish she'd come some other day. I have to write that letter to Amy.
I'm afraid you can't do that now.
It's a terribly difficult letter to write. Fearfully complicated.
Why?
Well, I've no people or anything.
No people with an aunt like that?
Well, I've no reason to expect anything from her, you know, more than she's already done. For which, of course, I'm very grateful and all that. It's just, I wanted to see Amy and put it to her that...
Charlie, I've got a clinking good idea.
Oh, Jack, you are a good chap. Write it down and I'll copy it out.
Oh, no, not for you. For me. Well, for us. You see, you're gone on Amy and I'm in love with Kitty.
Oh, really, Jack?
Yes, madly. More than anything I've ever taken up. Even cricket. I was trying to tell her so when you came in today. Here's the letter.
Oh, I'm so glad. What's your idea?
We'll hold a luncheon party for your aunt. Tea after in the garden.
In the garden?
Yes, I'll get leave.
But my rooms are so small.
Never mind, I'll lend you mine. The brass shall see to it. Brass it! Now come on, first we'll ask the girls.
Ask the girls?
She means your aunt.
What about old Spettigew?
I'll blow old Spettigew.
Oh no, but I forgot. He's up in town for a few days on business.
So much the better. Brass it! You write the note, go ahead. My dear Miss Spettigew, Brassage, where are you? Where are you? Get someone to send a note to Mrs. Spettigew's.
Yes, sir.
Yes, Jack, I've got that.
Would you and Miss Vernon do me the honor?
The honor?
Of lunching with me and Mr. Chesney.
Mr. Chesney?
I'll address the envelope.
I'll address the envelope.
Not that, you muff! At his rooms. St. Paul's College, today at 1 o'clock. Miss Spettigew.
Miss Spettigew.
Don't look out to meet my aunt. What did you say your name was, Charlie?
Donna Lucia Dalvadores.
Donna, all right, stick it down. An answer by bear will greatly oblige.
Yours truly, Charles Wickham.
Splendid, Jack. You'll be Prime Minister one of these days. It's a glorious opportunity. They're off to Scotland.
Yes, they went off down.
And now we shall have them all to ourselves.
The messenger, sir.
Give him this and tell him to look sharp.
Yes, sir.
This sort of thing is not to be said in my correspondence.
No, we shall have them all to ourselves.
Yes, and we could have done it if it hadn't been for your aunt. I'm beginning to love the dear old lady already. Brassett!
Yes, sir?
Lunch for five.
For how many, sir?
For five.
For five, sir?
What's so funny?
Well, sir, I'm afraid our credit in the kitchen is somewhat exhausted.
Oh, is it? How are you up with it, Charley?
Oh, well, I'm afraid my guardian's rather...
Is he? Never mind. Get it outside. Go to Bunter's.
Oh, I'm afraid we owe Bunter's.
Do we? Well, Charley, what do you think we should do?
I don't know, Jack.
Oh, well, perfect. It'll be off my checkpoint, yes? See what you can do on this.
Oh, this is no good, sir. I couldn't possibly get anything for this. However, sir, I have no doubt it will be all right at Bunter's if I say it's for me.
All right, whatever you say. Just remember, lunch for five at one.
Rather short notice, sir.
Don't fine. Go where you like, do what you like. Only remember, lunch for five at one. That'll be all right, won't it, Charley?
I say, Jack, that's my watch.
I beg your pardon, though, Jack, my mistake.
What wine, sir?
Champagne.
Very little left, sir.
Half a dozen bottles.
Oh, I think not, sir. Only four.
Oh, quite enough.
Six, I'll swear.
Beg your pardon, sir. Only four of champagne and one of claret.
Oh, hang that claret. It's been over a month. He's stolen those other two bottles, the corker.
Yes, my fellow's just the same.
They all are. Now, when you and your dear old aunt are looking at the chapels and the cloisters, I can have my chat with Kitty.
Well, yes, Jack, that's all fine and everything, but what about me and Amy and our little chat?
She'll be in our way horribly.
I didn't think of that.
I mean, she's already an excuse to get the girls to come, but on her own, she'll be an awful bore.
Oh, she'll be worse than that. She'll be a brute of a nuisance.
What are we to do?
Well, Napoleon went over the Alps on horseback, and I've been through them by train, so there must be a way through this.
Yes, but how? I mean, couldn't we get someone to meet her?
Yes, someone we can depend on. What about Brassett? He's a pompous sort of chap, and his armor is a corkscrew. Can't we dress him as a don or something for the day?
Well, that's an interesting idea, Jack.
Oh, but we shall want him to wait at the table.
Yes, so we shall.
There's Freddie Peel.
Oh, he's such a cynical chap.
Oh, yes, he neglects your aunt.
Yes, and he wants to make love to our girls.
By George, I've got it! Babs! Fanny Babs, we'll ask him!
Of course, why didn't we think of him before?
He's a jolly cheerful chap. He'll amuse your aunt to keep her in a rattling good humor.
Ah, splendid!
It's, Brassett!
Yes, sir?
Go to the old fan called Babley's rooms and ask him to come here at once.
Yes, sir.
And tell him it's very important.
Yes, sir.
And very immediate.
Yes, sir.
And while Babs is off doing gooseberry with your aunt, we can have our chat with the girls.
Yes, and by the by, Jack, talking of Babs's cheerfulness, haven't you noticed something about him lately, ever since he was so ill and had to go off to the Mediterranean?
Yes, I noticed he's been jolly hard up.
And I fancy from a few hints he's dropped that he's rather hard hit himself.
What, Babs in love?
And if I'm not very much mistaken, he's as soft-hearted over a girl as...
We are! All the better. He'll see the necessity of keeping the old girl well out of the way.
Splendid, Jack, you're a genius.
I'll be Prime Minister one of these days.
His lordship's compliments, sir, but he says he can't come. He has a luncheon party, and could you lend him a few bottles of champagne?
Lend him a few bottles of champagne? What on the cheek?
Who's he got coming?
Oh, probably Freddie Peel and a bunch of idiots like himself. They'll be howling comic songs all the afternoon.
Yeah, so it's not awfully annoying, won't it?
This won't do. Here, Brassett, late for six.
Yes, sir.
We must go to him. He can't upset our plans in this selfish way. Brassett, put that champagne on ice and tidy up my rooms, will you? Come on, Charlie, let's go.
One o'clock. Put my room in order first. Always the way. Hurry, scurry, no time for anything. They come with a bang, they go with a bang. Everything with a bang. Except pay their bills with a bang. And I thought this little perquisite was safe. Upon my word, I did.
Jack! I say Jack, old man! Where the dickens are you? I wanted to borrow some fizz. I wonder where they keep it. I George, the very thing! It serves him right. He shouldn't leave it about in this ostentatious way when I'm so beastly hard up. Won't they be jolly waxy? That's a bottle apiece that they must make out with whiskey and soda.
Bob! We just over to rooms to see you.
No, really. I say, how do you think I'm looking?
Oh, splendid old chap.
Yes, I thought you'd be pleased with me. Well, ta-ta, I'm off.
You wanted to talk to us, didn't you?
Yes, I wanted to borrow some fish.
Oh, I'm sorry, I can't. You know I would, but that's all brass.
I know. My fellow is just the same. There's no reasoning with them, is there? Well, ta-ta, I'm off.
I'm off. We looked you out last night, but you were out.
Yes, you know Freddie Peel, don't you?
Yes.
He's an awful idiot. Hasn't a particle of brains, has he? But I'm all right. He gave a card party last night, and I won £100 from him. You should have seen his face. It makes me laugh now.
Why, Freddie Peel hasn't sixpence.
No, really?
Did he pay you?
No, but he's going to when his grandmother dies.
The old lady's been dead years.
No, really? That's beastly. You know, I'm stumped. And he's had an awful lot out of me. But he's an awful idiot. Hasn't a particle of brains, has he? But I'm all right. Well, ta-ta, I'm off.
Back! You must stay in lunch with us today.
Oh, I say, you chaps, don't play the giddy goat. I've got to beat my tutor.
Babs, you're looking quite cooled down.
Am I really?
Oh, yes, I was just saying so to Jack just now.
Well, do you think I shall die?
Oh, no, not you, but you mustn't worry over all this study. You'll be a great man of one sort one of these days without all that.
Well, that's what I think, you know, but I ought to do something. We've had a wonderful lot of jollies in our family, great jollies in the Army and Navy and things.
Well, I'll bet they didn't kill themselves with study.
No, but I must do something.
Yes, you must stay at lunch with us today. Charlie's aunt's going to pay him a visit.
No, really? What fun! I know Charlie visits his uncle sometimes when he's hard up. It's only right his aunt should return the visit.
Now that's just the sort of thing we want, a jolly smart chap like you with a fund of humor and a brilliant conversation.
Yes, Babs, that's it.
To interest and amuse a charming lady.
Yes, who is she?
Why, Charlie's aunt.
Well, what's she like?
Well, you see, Babs, we don't quite know. I'm to meet her today for the first time.
Oh, I say, Charlie, she may turn out to be an awful old crock.
Well, she's a widow and a millionaire. That's enough, isn't it?
Rather. Put me down for a chance, Charlie. I'll take a chance.
And we didn't care to ask Freddie Peel, did we, Charlie?
No.
No, he's an awful idiot. I say, what's her name?
Donna Lucia Delvedores.
Oh, damn it, what a name.
Now look, you must stay lunch with us today. You'll find Charlie's aunt a charming old lady.
Charming old lady? I say, look here, haven't you got anything younger coming?
Oh, yes, two other ladies.
Ah, nice, young?
Yes.
Now that is more in my line. How many did you say?
Two.
Oh, I see. One for each of you and the old crock for me. No thanks, I'm off!
This is awfully serious affair!
Well, I should think so with an old crock like that!
Look, we want your help as a friend we can trust.
Right,
we'll put you in our confidences. No humbug, straight as a die, we're in love.
What? Charlie as well, you silly ass!
And it's no full interpretation business, but the real, downright serious thing.
Yes, and Babs, if you knew the girls as well as we do, you wouldn't wonder at it.
And they're coming here to lunch today.
I say, have you proposed?
No, that's just the thing.
Ah, I see. So you want me to propose for you?
No, of course not. We'll do that ourselves. Why have asked them here today?
You know, Babs, you don't understand our feelings a bit.
Oh, don't I don't? I say, haven't you noticed how sad I've been lately?
Yes.
Well, what is it?
Well, I don't know, but I think I may be in love too.
And what makes you think so?
Well, I'm always wanting to be alone and hear the birds sing. I'm getting so fond of poetry and I can't sleep. I took to drink for a couple of days and it made me ill for a week, so I left it all.
Well, you've got all the symptoms. Sit down and tell us about it.
You remember when I was plowed?
Beastly shame.
No, not last time, the term before. I was awfully ill and I took the yacht round to the Mediterranean. And at Monte Carlo, I came across an English officer named Delaney, quite penniless and dying. You know, Jack, he tried to commit suicide.
Oh. Bad luck at the tables, hmm?
Yes, he beggared himself and his only child, the sweetest little girl you ever saw, Jack. To amuse him and keep his spirits up, I used to play cards with him.
And what came of him?
He died, the poor fellow.
What became of her, the sweetest little girl you ever saw?
I lost sight of her. A lady traveling home that way from South America, I believe, took charge of her and brought her to England. You know, Jack, I tried to tell her that...
That you loved her.
But she was in such grief that
it all oozed out of your fingertips and the tips of your hair.
But after all, you know, I might have been rejected and I should have looked a silly out.
Well, at any rate, you can sympathize with us. Here's the messenger back. Grab it. Go on, then. It's very important. They're coming!
By Jove!
So they are.
So you'll stay, Babs.
Oh, I say, look here.
No, you'll do as you are. I won't let you go now that we've got you.
No, I say, look here, Jack. Don't play the giddy goat. I've got something else to do.
What is it?
It's something awfully important.
Well, what?
I'm going to play in some amateur theatricals.
Oh, rot, we'll be ploughed again, won't you, Charlie?
But I've given my word.
What are you playing?
A lady. An old lady, and... I've never acted in my life before.
So that's his tutor, huh, Charlie?
And I want to try on the things before those fellows come.
Oh, well, you can do that here. Where are they?
Well, they're in my rooms in a box on the bed.
Fetch them, Rassi, quick!
No, I'll fetch them with my little bag!
Miss, your Babs can sympathize with us a bit.
Oh, don't I, though? I only wish I could see my own little girl.
Well, you should turn up one of these days. Here, have a drink.
Oh, thanks, I've knocked it over.
Oh, just a small one.
I'm teetotal.
All right, here you are, Charlie.
Oh, no thanks.
I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll drink to her, wherever she is. Here's to the future Lady Fancourt Baddeley. What did you say her name was?
Haven't the slightest idea.
Go on with you. To Miss Delahaye.
Your things, my lord.
Ah! Thank you, Brass, but you're an awfully good chap. I said, Jack, could you lend me half a crown?
Charlie, have you had a crown?
No, Jack, I haven't.
Brassett, let me have a crown, will you?
Certainly, sir.
Babs?
Ah, thank you.
Yes.
Brassett! Here you are.
So what have we got there?
Chocolates.
Chocolates.
Let's have a look.
No. I'll tell you what, I'll try them on after lunch while you're out in the garden.
No, that won't do. Try them on now. It won't take long, will it?
Only a minute or two. I've lost an awful lot of time over these theatricals. But next term, I mean to work!
Oh, yes, here it is. Excuse the name. Oh, so it is. Mr. Chesley. I wonder if they're in.
Here they are. Your aunt's not come yet.
What are we going to do?
We can let them in. We can explain. It's sure they pass it. Ah, so nice to see you. How are you?
Oh, we were so pleased to be able to come, weren't we, Amy? Oh, yes. Mr. Wickham, are we too early?
Oh, no.
Yes, Mr. Chesney, you didn't mention any time.
Oh, no, not at all. We're delighted to see you.
So this is where you've been, studying and doing all of your work, everything.
Yes, we do a lot of studying here.
Oh, well, you've jolly courses here.
We're so glad to see that you were able to come here tonight. You're off to Scotland tomorrow, and we shall miss you so much.
Oh, yes. Uncle always takes us to some dreadfully remote places this time of year, where we never see a soul, and it's so dreary.
Why does he?
I don't know.
It's a shame.
Why, are you sorry we're going?
Sorry? Why to put me, and Jack, into a perfect fever? That's why we're so anxious to see you here today.
It's lucky Uncle is away in town, or I don't think we could have come.
Why?
I don't know, but he raises such odd objections, and then you know he's so peculiar about Kitty.
Why?
She is an heiress, you know, and he's her guardian.
You know, Kitty, I'll never forget about the dance the other evening, will you?
No.
Those moments in the moonlight was some of the very best of my life. Moonlight is the true atmosphere for sentiments.
I wonder how many people have said that.
Now, Kitty, I know in your life you can be an awful plague, but today you're being quite cynical.
I know I am. I'm thinking of that man.
What man?
Of my guardian, Mr. Svedigue, who hurries us away from all of our best friends directly when we get to know anyone really well for fear of
what?
I don't know.
But why does he?
Because he's a selfish, wicked old man.
You're not really sad to go, are you?
No, I'm angry, but I shan't speak of it anymore. Or, as Amy says, I shall cry. What a dear, sweet old lady you are, must be, Mr. Wickham. I am longing to know her. Where is she?
Jack!
What?
Where's my aunt?
What?
I don't know.
I'm afraid she's not quite come yet.
Oh, no, Kitty! Mr. Wickham's aunt hasn't come yet.
Hasn't come?
Oh, then we'll run and do some shopping and then come back. Don't be long. Goodbye.
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 Goodbye. Goodbye. You see that? I don't think a shop when they found your aunt wasn't here.
Makes an awful difference, doesn't it?
Go off to the station and bundle the old girl up in a fly.
Right. The old girl, what do you mean?
Your aunt!
Oh, right. Oh, I say, Jack, I do feel better after seeing them, don't you?
Yes, now be off!
Right.
Oh, the imbecile!
I say, old chap, have you got any hairpins?
The hairpins? Great Scott, no.
Well, may I send your man for some?
Yes, certainly.
I say, have you got sixpence?
Afraid not.
You haven't got anything. I said, Ralph, I gave you half a crown just now. Do you mind making it 2 shillings and getting me 6 penny worth of hairpins?
Certainly, my lord.
Keep change. I said, Jack, were those the girls?
Yes, what the deuce made you jump out like that? They might have seen you.
I didn't know they were here.
Here's someone else. Be off. Oh, by George, there was a lot of hope in what Kitty said. In a few more minutes, I'd have told her everything. But never mind. Come in.
Jack!
Jack!
My dear boy.
Oh, man, how have you been?
Oh, good time, my lad, to have a chat with you and to bring you your check.
Thanks, Dad, you're a Brit.
A bit of a bit, my boy, after all my years in India.
A bit crisp, but a humbug, Victorian.
Am I? How do you make that out?
How old are you?
What do you say to 50?
50?
What?
Who'd believe it?
And you, Jack, seem much older than I was at your age. I suppose it's the times. Even the old comet shows it. New ivy, new paint.
Alma mater's an old beauty still, Jack.
I suppose she is by aid of the gentle artifices of the twilight. Well, we all grow old.
And as presently as possible. Why, even you at 50.
What?
At 50 would have been a stout, white-haired, bald, top-booted, domineering old boy, yet here you are, a vague-up-to-date sort of chap who can talk to you like a chum. However, have you done it?
Don't know.
Do you drink?
All I want?
Well,
never noticed.
Well, there we have it. Consequently, health good, temper perfect. We are going to be great pals, Dad.
Here you are, my boy. There's your check to go on with.
Thank you. You know, I haven't had enough of you these days.
I see your hospitality.
Oh, I hope.
Never mind. Say when I was a lad.
I've been over that wine monstrously.
Have you? Never mind, so has I. Done over everything monstrously at college, but settled up. I'm very satisfied with you. It's something to go down from college with a record like yours. I say, Jack, where the deuce did you get the cigars?
Those, Dad.
That accounts for the bill. Now, my lad, we must begin to think.
Hey.
Now that I've come into the family title, which you know, I've also, which you don't know, come into the family debts and difficulties.
Debts?
Which are far more than I expected. As a result, all the money I've been saving for you in India goes to pay them. And in short, Jack, you and I, for the next 3 years, will be, comparatively speaking, poor men.
Poor men? Well, this settles me with old Svedigue.
However, I have hopes for a small appointment for you in Calcutta.
Calcutta? What a horrible confound it all, Rasta, what do you want?
His lordship's hairpins, sir.
Confound his hairpins! Oh, the dial will be an odd one. I must get rid of Babs if he stays. Stays? Why not? Dad, could this sort of thing be settled by a wealthy marriage?
No, that's the sort of thing I'd rather deprecate. I don't think, Jack, I'd advise you.
Oh, no. Not for me, Dad. For you.
Me? You young rascal? No! No, I shall never marry again.
Oh, don't be silly, Dad. You see, my friend Charley, his aunt, Aunt Lucy Dalvatoris, is coming here to lunch today. She's a widow.
A widow?
And a millionaire.
A millionaire?
And a charming woman.
No, Jack. I don't think I'd advise you to do a thing of this kind.
No, Dad, just think it through. And go to the hotel. Where are your things?
At the hotel.
Well, go and get them and put on something nice and come back here for lunch at 1. And, Dad, put a flower in your buttonhole.
Jack!
Dad, Charley Wickham. Charley, my father.
Glad to know you, my boy. Glad to know you.
Her nephew, nice boy, you'll like
him. I thought it was a fire brigade.
Dad, go back, put a flower in your buttonhole. It takes years on the man to flower in his buttonhole.
No, Jack, you come to lunch with me at the lunch.
Don't be rash, Dad. See her first. See her first.
I'll have a look at her.
All right. See you at 1 o'clock, Dad. Well, what is it?
Read that.
Important business. Don't expect me for a few days. Don Lucia Dalvatoris? No!
She's not coming.
Well, she must. Go. Wire. Telegraph. Something.
It's no use. There's no time now.
But the girls won't stay without a chaperone.
Well, couldn't we get someone to see her? Old Mrs. What's-her-face, the proctor's wife.
Oh, she'd sit and stare like an owl.
Well, what are we going to do now?
I said, Jack, come and look at me.
Oh, what is it?
Well, I'll go and take these things off.
But they won't stay if you give you.
Won't stay? What do you mean?
You must be Charlie's aunt.
Me?
Yes.
Oh, no!
Go to the classroom! Just sit down! Shut up, Rossett! Oh, you got back. So nice to see you again.
Yes, we've been longer than intended because Amy wished to pick up some flowers for Charlie's aunt. Has she come?
Yes, has she? I hope she's come.
Yeah, she's come. Donna Lucia, Miss Verdon, and Miss Spencer. Donna Lucia Dalvatoris, Charlie's aunt. Well, go ahead, say something.
How do you do, my dears?
We called upon you before, Donna Lucia, but you hadn't arrived. And we brought you these.
Oh, thank you.
I hope your journey from town hasn't tired you.
Oh, no. It was very jolly. pleasant, I mean. What the deuce am I to do with these things?
Stick in the dress.
You look worried, Mr. Wickham. Are you ill?
No, I'm just a little anxious.
But Charlotte's a bit affected today at seeing this aunt for the first time. Why the dickens don't you say something?
What the dickens am I to say?
Tell me about the weather.
Charming weather?
Oh, yes, it's quite charming.
College gents will do anything.
You know, you're placing me in a terribly false position.
May I arrange these for you, Donna Lucia?
Oh, yes.
After all, you know, we do have some nice weather sometimes in poor old England.
What on earth does she mean by that?
You're a foreigner.
A foreigner? What did you say my name was?
Donna Lucia Dalvatoris.
What am I? Irish?
No, English. You married a Portuguese abroad.
A widow. From Brazil. And a millionaire.
I said, Charlie, have I any children?
No, you fool!
Well, one ought to know! That's all right. Now I can go ahead. Yes, it is wonderful weather for England.
Yes, it is.
Shall I take them to the chapel in the cloisters?
Oh, you can leave that to Charlie and I.
Of course, Oxford is all very new to you, Tana Lucia, but it's a dear old place in any weather. Amy and I will show you all about.
Oh, I should be delighted.
You're staying until tomorrow, are you not?
Am I staying until tomorrow?
No, no.
Oh, but you will. You must. Mustn't she, Kitty?
I'm afraid Auntie can't stay after today.
No, you see, it's my washing day.
Auntie has a lot of business to attend to in town.
Yes, lawyers and stocks.
Yes, stocks and socks. All very important, you know.
Oh, I'm so sorry. We have so long to know you.
Oh. Have you, my dear?
Mr. Wickham has told us so much about you that he has made us quite love you.
Oh. Has he, my dear?
And oh, he is so grateful. He says he owes everything to you and he can never repay you. And he is such a good, frank, upright man. It was noble of you.
Oh, yes. It was only my duty to see after my poor brothers.
Sisters, you fool!
Sisters, you fool! And brother-in-law's orphan girl.
Boy.
I'll say twins in a minute.
Yes, but it was so good of you to find out. You were so far away in a foreign land, and he could have been left to starve or to fall into cool hands. But you have a good, kind, affectionate nature.
Have I, my dear?
Anyone can see it in your face.
No.
I feel like I told my whole heart to you.
Yes. Don't let her. I'm not going to, dear thing.
You don't mind me talking to you like this, do you?
Oh. My dear, you are a charming little girl with whom I'm sure I could soon grow very fond of. And you must tell me all you like someday when you know me better.
Oh, I feel I've known you years and years already.
Oh. Oh, I'm sorry, they're jealous. It was very kind. I liked it.
Brassett, is there someone at the door?
I beg your pardon, Mr. Chesney. I just heard Mr. Spetsky with the gate inquiring for your rooms.
Oh, dear, I'll pull them back. I beg of you, Mr. Chesney, do send him away.
Someone answer that door.
What? You won't.
I wish to see Mr. Chester.
Where did you get that hat? Take it off, sir. Don't sit down. I'm not sitting down. I didn't ask you to sit down.
We'll wait that for the present, madam. I wish to see Mr. Chesney at once.
Well, you can't see him. He's not present. I am the only person present.
But the porter told me that two young ladies, my niece and my ward, were here.
And I tell you that I am the only young lady present.
But he told me he saw them come in.
And didn't he tell you he saw them come out?
No.
Very well, then. What more do you want?
They've gone into the garden.
They've done nothing of the kind!
Then, they've gone into town.
But then why couldn't you think of that before?
And now, sir, having got all the information that you were likely to get in your present condition,
madam, disgraceful, where have you been?
You mean, madam, I'm annoyed but perfectly sober.
Well, you don't look it.
Other people can be annoyed as well as yourself. Ma'am, I apologize. Good day. Did you see anything strike that hat?
I beg your pardon?
Did you see anything strike that hat? He wants me to do it again.
Lucia.
What, you haven't got any?
Well, I thought you'd forget something, so I brought some with me. In my bag. In my bag present.
So I was right after all, and that old fool of a woman told me they were not here.
Mrs. Pettigrew, please allow me to explain.
Not address me, sir. And this is how you take advantage of my absence?
Mrs. Pettigrew, if you would allow me
don't
to explain.
Don't address me, sir. I have no wish to hold any converse with you.
Oh, but won't you allow us to explain?
My business is with this young man, sir, not with you.
But you won't listen to either of them.
Go away, madam, and don't interfere.
Where did you get that hat? Take it off, sir.
You forget yourself, sir.
Perhaps you'll remember, sir, that ladies are present.
I disapprove of their presence, and I request them to return with me.
We can discuss this matter on a more fitting occasion.
Yes, a most excellent suggestion. Let them come again.
You are a foolish old woman, and I must beg of you not to interfere. Ladies, come.
Sir, you cannot put such an affront upon Mr. Wickham's friends.
I don't know them. I don't know them.
Introduce me, Mr. Wickham.
Mrs. Spedicky, Sir Francis Chesney.
Mr. Chesney is my son, sir, and this lady is...
Pray don't introduce him to me. I've been sufficiently insulted by the old man. Gentlemen already.
I consult my own feelings when I say I am deeply annoyed to find, on prematurely returning from town, my niece and my ward lunching without my permission with these two young gentlemen.
To meet Mr. Wickham's aunt.
Oh, indeed.
There's no oh, indeed about it, sir. I repeat, to meet Mr. Wickham's aunt.
In my mind, it matters little.
In my mind, it matters everything. Therefore, allow me to introduce you, Donna Lucia Alvadores, Mr.
What's his confounded name?
Jack Spettigue.
Spettigue.
Donna Lucia? Celebrated millionaire. Oh, how do you do?
How do you do? I'm Charley, from Brazil, where the nuts come from.
I've been indiscreet. I am sorry. Very, very sorry.
Joe always apologized, asking a lunch.
Well, I thought you were very rude, but if you apologize, you know.
By all means, I am sorry. I am very sorry.
You'll stay to lunch, won't you?
If you wish it. And, am I forgiven?
Forgiven! Here! Accept this as a peace offering.
My flower! Allow me, Donna.
Oh, no, allow me.
Oh!
Sailing along. He makes a wonderful old lady, not a doubt about it. A bit singular to look at, perhaps, but then look at some of your old ladies. Nobody believe it possible. He don't seem no worse to look at than two or three I could mention, holding very high positions, too. Both the old gents have got their eye on her. Lord, if they only knew. I fancy Sir Francis is favored, though old Spettigue fancies himself. College gents will do anything.
What are you laughing at?
I was, beg your pardon, sir. I was just remembering an old aunt of mine. Uncle, I mean.
Mind your own business and go and get tea. Do you see tea?
Tea, sir. Yes, sir.
Out here.
Out here, sir.
Well, don't stare at me like that. I've got special permission.
Oh, beg your pardon, sir.
Well, now for Kitty. Everything's going along all right. Babs has scared the life out of me 2 or 3 times, the way he's rushed into things as if he hadn't had food for a month, but all the same, everything's going along splendidly. I've arranged for Kitty to meet me here. Here she is now. Don't hang it! I've got a most important appointment here with Kitty, so get out!
Well, so have I, Jack.
With Kitty?
No, with Amy.
They both made appointments in the same place. What are we to do?
Well, they are your rooms.
Yes, but you're my guest. Here, we'll task for it. Do you have any money?
Hey, Penny, that's all.
All right. Heads, you and Amy. Tails, me and Kitty. Here she is now.
Jack, that's all the money I've got.
Oh, Mr. Chesney, there you are.
Yes, I was here, in fact. Waiting. I was beginning to hear you wouldn't come.
Won't you go? Have you no tact? What about me and Amy?
Ah, Mr. Wickham, there you are.
Yes, I'm here. I was just waiting. Here I am. I'm here.
Beastly awkward. I say, Charlie, has Miss Pettigrew seen the garden?
Yes, Jack, she has. Two or three times, in fact. We've just come from there. I wish she'd leave us.
Lovely garden, isn't it?
Yes, I suppose it is.
Suppose? Well, you haven't seen the half of it. Charlie, Miss Pettigrew has not seen half the garden. Go and show her the roses and primroses and cabbages and things. And while you're there, tell her those beautiful lines you wrote to our garden in summer.
Don't tell her I write poetry. She'll think I'm an awful ass.
And don't forget Miss Pettigrew tea in half an hour.
Oh, very well, Mr. Chesney.
But check the others are in the garden, and it worries the life out of me to see Babs.
Well, don't see him. It's an awfully large garden. Stay out of his way.
Don't you think it was rather rude of us, Mr. Chesney, to send them away like that?
But we tossed for it.
What?
I mean, they'll be much happier together alone, and it seems I haven't been able to get 5 minutes alone without you, without some awful interruption.
Oh, no, not at all. I couldn't expect you to devote yourself entirely to me. Indeed, we've had a very pleasant time, and now...
Yes, and now?
Well, I was thinking we ought to be going now.
Going? Now? No!
Why not?
Before I've had a word with you, won't you sit down?
Indeed, Mr. Chesney.
You see, Kitty, there are times when a man must think a lot and think long.
Yes.
And there are times when a man mustn't stop to think, for if he does, he'll spoil his chances.
I suppose so.
Well, then, Kitty, my dear Kitty, there is something very...
Oh, I beg pardon. No, don't mind me. I only wanted a word with my boy here. Yeah?
Oh, then I'll go out into the garden and see the roses and primroses and cabbages and things.
Well, is that anything important?
Yes, Jack, it is.
Well, what is it?
You know, I'll do anything to see you get on in the world and make a mark, as I know you will, if you get your chance.
You didn't tell me all this, Dad.
Well, Jack, having thought it over, I've decided you shall continue the career I originally mapped out for you, and seeing a way through the difficulty, I have determined to take your advice, my boy, and marry a lady of wealth.
So I see you fall into the fascinations of some young and lovely woman.
No, Jack. She is not lovely. And I'm afraid she's not overly young. But she has one thing in her favor. She has money, which after all is the real object of this occasion.
No, Dad, as long as you're satisfied, go in and win.
And I have you to thank, my boy, for the tip.
Thank me for the tip. But Dad, I can't remember. What's her name?
You'll be delighted when I tell you.
Yes, well.
Can't you guess?
No, I can't.
Donna Lucia de Alvatorius.
Dad, this is impossible.
Impossible? Why, you yourself suggested it, my boy. And for your sake, I'm going to do it.
Dad, you can't.
Can't? Why not? Is there anything against a lady's reputation?
Well, no. But you mustn't. You can't.
Mustn't? Can't? What a boy you are, Jack. Did you tell me to go to the hotel, change my things, and put a flower in my buttonhole? George, Jack, I believe the flower's done the trick.
She gave it away, Dad.
My dear boy, she's explained all that.
Oh, this is horrible. Dad, circumstances have altered since then.
In what way?
Well, you're not the man to be thrown away like
say
this.
Say no more, my boy. Your consideration for me settles it. It'll put you forward years. Had she been young and lovely, she wouldn't have looked at me. As it is, I flatter myself she's taken rather a fancy to me. As for old Spectacue, in spite of his marked attention, I don't think he has a ghost of a chance with me.
Spedicue! Attentions! What have I done? Dad!
So wish me luck, my boy, wish me luck!
Dad, take some time, think it through.
Think it through? That's not how an old soldier makes love. I'm going into your room and get myself a rattling good spanking and brandy and soda to bring me up to the mark. What have I done?
Jack, I wish you'd speak to Babs. He's carrying on disgracefully.
He's taken Amy away from me and gone down the garden with her.
Well, that's nothing to what's going on here.
Oh, did you hear that?
Yes, what is it?
Just my dad pouring himself a rattling good spanking brandy and soda.
Brandy and soda? What for?
Oh, to propose to Babs, that's all.
Propose to Babs? What should we find out disgraced? How could you let this go on?
Well, don't blame me for this. It's the fault of your muddle-headed aunt, not knowing her own mind and leaving us in the lurch like this. I can strangle her.
Well, what shall we do?
We must find Babs and put her up to the governor's game.
Find Babs?
Yes, we'll go around the garden in the ways until we've got him.
But Jack, can't you
end this? We must keep our heads now or ruin everything. Come on!
Oh.
Now I'm ready for anybody or anything. Why doesn't she come? I didn't tell the dear boy, more particularly since she raised objection, that she promised to meet me here in 10 minutes, and time is up. Time is up! Ah, Donald, that old fool spit at you with my flower in his coat. Are you looking for anybody?
No.
What's he hanging about here for? Are you in want of anything?
No. I was only thinking that it was a very lovely afternoon. Perhaps you haven't seen the garden. It's looking very beautiful. You ought to give it a good look at it before you go.
I will, before I go. What's he hanging about here for? Have a cigarette?
No, I never smoke in the daytime. Why does he remain? And she promised to meet me here in 10 minutes, and the time's up. Thank God.
What's he stopping for? I must tell him to go.
I wish I could think of something to get rid of him.
Well, as you are not smoking.
Oh, don't mind me. Don't mind me.
I was only thinking. Perhaps it would be as well you rejoin the ladies in the garden. Then they think it rude, both of us being away.
Perhaps so. Perhaps so. She's in the garden.
Well, she doesn't appear to be coming, so I think I'll go and get myself another rattling good spanking brandy and soda.
Dad, you haven't seen Donna Lucia, have you?
No, Jack, I have not.
That's fortunate.
I'm waiting for her here.
Waiting for her here?
Yes, I have an appointment with her. I didn't tell you before, but she's due. In fact, she's overdue, so get out, my boy, get out.
You mustn't leave until I've seen Babs. Dad, come to think of it, I just saw Donna Lucia.
Oh, where?
In the garden.
In the garden?
Yes.
Hang it, I just sent old spit at you there.
Well, I know Babs isn't there. Where is he? Have you found him?
No, haven't you?
No, and I looked everywhere for him.
And the worst of it is he has Amy with them. It's a shame.
They're all killed, little monkey, while I get over him.
Oh, would you look at that?
Mr. Wickham, there you are. Did you think we'd lost them?
Yes, I'm afraid I had.
Where have you been with the girl, you fool?
Nowhere.
Now stay where you are. Something to tell you. Miss Spedigue, have you seen the chapel? Take her away when I talk to Babs. You must see the chapel. It's an awfully pretty chapel.
I'll punch his head if he does it again, Jack.
What do you mean by this fool of a game?
What fool of a game?
You promised to help us.
Well, I'm doing my best.
Doing your best? Your job was to look after those two old gentlemen, and now here you are. But I've no wish to argue.
No, I shouldn't argue if I were you.
I wanted to put you on your guard.
On my guard? Oh, thank you.
Yes. My dad is going to propose to you.
Jack,
waiting for you or anybody else, I'll see you hanged first!
Of course not, you idiot! All you have to do is be calm and refuse him.
Be calm and refuse him? But a proposal puts anyone in a flutter, you know that.
All you have to do is remember that you're a real old lady.
Well, how the dickens am I to remember that I'm a real old lady with my trousers on?
Never mind the trousers. Here's the dad, I'm off.
Well, what am I to say? I've never been proposed to before.
Say he's taken you by surprise, but whatever you do, mind you refuse him.
Oh, yes. I'll refuse him.
Really, it's too bad. She made the proposition herself. It was a definite proposition of her own. Well, ladies are proverbially unpunctual.
Yoo-hoo!
Ah, Donna Lucia, there you are. I was beginning to be afraid. Pop into the garden to find you. It's so good of you to come. Won't you sit down? By Jove, I've got her at last. Now for the plunge. I'll begin with a compliment. I wonder what her real age is. However, a lady's never too old for a compliment. So here goes. Donna Lucia, you'll pardon the rude metaphor of an old campaigner, I'm sure. But to meet you today for the first time, as I have, is to me like a lonely traveler coming across some bright little floweret by the wayside.
Do you mean me?
Yes, Donna Lucia, yes. By George, that's a good start.
What am I to say to that? Oh, God. Oh, that is very nice and very kind of you.
By George, she looks anything between 50 and 100. Well, I brought myself to it, so I'll come to the point. Donna Lucia, do you know what a man longs for when he's lonely, desolate, wretched?
A drink?
Yes. No. What a woman. Doesn't help at all. No, Donna Lucia. This is what he longs for. He longs to plant in his own heart that bright little floweret. Oh,
I knew. By the wayside. That one. Does he really?
And I've come all the way from India to find that little floweret.
Well, you must be tired. Take a chair.
Thank you, Donna Lucia. It is a long way.
Oh, quite a long walk.
But I have found it.
Well, then why don't you wear it in your buttonhole?
Will you let me? Or will it be given away to another as you've done before?
Oh, yes. I remember. Whew. I was a naughty girl this morning, wasn't I?
My dear Lucia,
he's getting on!
The floweret I mean must sit at the head of my table, walk by my side, dwell in my heart forever.
He's going to show me a conjuring trick.
Let all waste no more words. Come to the point where the soldier's bluntness. Will you be my wife? Will you be my floweret?
Well, you see, you've taken me so much by surprise.
Then I may hope.
I'm afraid not. No. I wouldn't hope if I were you.
Oh, I beg pardon, Donna Lucia. Do I understand?
I must refuse you. The fact of the matter is, I am another's.
Another?
Oh, don't be so downhearted. I'll tell you what I'll do if you like.
Yes, yes.
I will
be a sister to you.
A sister? Only a sister?
Only a sister. Nothing more.
And no words of mine can alter your decision?
I'm afraid not. You see, I am in a more peculiar position than you could ever imagine. I am a woman with a history.
Then there's no use us prolonging this interview. And you'll accept my regrets and apologies for ever broaching the subject.
Oh, certainly. Any time you are pussy.
Refused. What a relief. I'm sorry, though, for the boy's sake.
You fool! What did you want to make a fool of my dad like that for?
Well, I didn't make a fool of the fool, you fool! Didn't you hear what he called me?
Yes, a floweret.
Yes, by the wayside. That's a good thing, isn't it?
Why didn't you just refuse him?
Well, I couldn't refuse him until he proposed. No lady could. Or I shall find myself in the divorce court before I know where I am. Look out, here's old Spedic you coming. I'm gonna land him one, I know I shall. Come on!
Mr. Chesney, if you see...
What the deuce did he bolt like that for? At any rate, they mustn't wreck my future happiness. I must find Kitty. Oh, why couldn't Charlie's aunt behave like she promised? I hate the sight of her before I've even seen her.
My dear. How strange. The name sounds familiar. Why couldn't my nephew have remained in his rooms and not compel me to follow him about like this?
You telegraphed to say you couldn't come.
I know, my dear.
But then you changed your mind.
Yes, for about the first time in my life.
Why?
Some vague desire to see him without his knowing. Knock again, dear. Dream away, Ella. I shall wait till someone comes.
Live among the leafy shades, ancient spires and sculptured nooks. Like silent music, a scholar's fairyland.
Yes, but for one sublimary little, being, not as young as she used to be, a little fatiguing.
And how lovely it must be by the moonlight, where the shadows have no sudden fears, but only folds in the mantle of sleep. And all is peace, and silver bells chime to the sentinel angel of night, who smiles to the heavens and whispers back, "All's well, sweet elf. All's well."
You fanciful little woman. But what has put all this about angels and such into your head today?
I don't know.
I think I can trace back all the little byways and sly ways of thought that generally point in one direction.
No, it's all so sweet here.
So it was by moonlight, on the bridge of a certain yacht, the rippling sea, the blue night, the brilliant stars, and a certain someone who told you as you listened to the chime of the ship's bell that you looked like the angel of the watch. He was a flattering-tongued person, that someone. What was his name again?
I've told you so often.
Lord Fancourt Baverley. But I don't want your mind fixed on such things, my dear. Why, I had nearly forgotten to tell you. I've invested your forefather's money for you, and thanks to his forethought for his little girl, he has made you independent for life. And what's worse, independent of me.
Independent?
But you won't be, Ella.
No.
For I've grown to love the little orphan that I met in such grief in a strange land so much that I am not independent of her. So let's make a bargain. put that dreadful evidence of my dependence aside and let it grow and be my little girl and call me Auntie, won't you?
Yes, Auntie, yes.
How did your poor father happen to have such a large sum of money by him like that? I thought he lost it all.
Papa wanted a card.
Wanted a card? When?
During his illness.
From who?
From Lord Fancourt Beverley.
Is Lord Beverley a gambler too?
No.
Oh.
But Auntie, if ever we meet, may you get back?
Oh, I don't think he'd take it.
Why not?
Seems to me he took too much trouble to lose it. But I'm not going to speak for him. I don't want you to ever leave me. Ah, my dear, you've started me thinking now.
Have I? What about?
Oh, about someone who...
Oh, do tell me.
It was before I went abroad to Brazil. I was very young, and he was very shy. He never called me the angel of the watch. But he did manage a stammering compliment and a blush. And then?
And then?
Then he was ordered off with his regiment.
Without ever.
Without ever.
Oh, Auntie.
It was at a dance the evening before he went away.
And you never loved anyone since?
I was a sentimental young lady in those days.
What was his name, Auntie?
Frank Chesney. Strange. Oh, I'm afraid we're interrupting.
Oh, not at all. The college grounds are open to everyone. I am, so to speak, at home here, merely because these are my son's rooms.
Mr.
Chesney.
And pardon my asking, but are you, or rather were you, Lieutenant Frank Chesney?
I was.
And you don't remember me.
I acknowledge with regret that I have no recollection whatever.
It must be nearly 20 years since...
20 years?
He doesn't remember me.
20 years is a long time, Auntie.
20 years? Where was the regiment then, I wonder?
Mrs. Beverly Smythe. Everyone's card but my own, of course. Then you've forgotten the day you first embarked for it?
No.
Then you've forgotten the evening before?
No, not altogether.
Then?
Lucy! Good gracious! And to think that, at that very dance? But you don't remember that, of course.
No?
No, because you never knew. But that night, by George, I nearly made you an avowal that, and we never met in all that time. Nearly, well, over 20 years, we'll say.
I'm afraid so.
I remember the dance perfectly. You were in white. Tied up in blue.
Tied up in blue like a chocolate box.
You should see my son. He's a splendid fellow. And these are his rooms, or rather he has lent them to a college friend. A young fellow named Wickham.
Wickham?
Who's entertaining some ladies. Two young ladies on his aunt.
His aunt?
A lady from Brazil.
From Brazil?
Donna Lucia de Alvedorans. Oh. I must introduce you.
Auntie, what does he mean?
Wait a moment, my dear. Do I understand you to say that Donna Lucia d'Alvedores is here, actually here?
In the garden? Well, what's 5 minutes ago? Do you know her?
I've heard of her. Shall I stay and see this through or go back to town?
May I trouble you?
Oh, certainly.
Mrs. Beverly Smythe.
Auntie.
Shh. I will find Donna Lucia and the boys, or perhaps you wouldn't mind going into the garden to them.
With pleasure. I'm quite curious to see them. This is my niece, Miss Delahaye.
Oh, delighted. How do you do?
Colonel?
Sir Francis Chesney.
Come, Ella.
Jack, my boy, had that been Donna Lucia, things might have been very different.
Oh, his lordship's up to the old gen now. Looks as if they're having a game of some kind.
I think it's very dangerous running about like that. I'm not sure I didn't catch sight of his lordship's trousers.
Now, at last, my dear Kitty, we're alone.
But Jack, look.
Confound it all, Brassett, what are you doing?
I'm laying the cloth for tea, sir.
Well, get out.
But you gave orders, sir.
Well, push it back a half an hour, quick, man. Can't you see I'm engaged?
Really, sir? I congratulate you.
Busy, confound you. Get out and don't come back. And now, Kitty, my dear Kitty.
Yes, Jack, you've said that before.
Now, don't interrupt me. I go straight at most things, and I'm not going to hesitate over this.
Is it that you attach so much importance to it, or that you just don't care about what you do?
It's both mixed. So Kitty, my dear Kitty.
Yes, Jack?
To be serious, in a few hours, you'll be hundreds of miles away, and it could be years before we see each other again, unless... Unless
what?
Won't you listen?
I can't help myself.
I've told you how my father intended me for Parliament and all that.
Yes?
Well, he tells me now I may have to give up all that and pursue my own living.
Well, that will do you no harm, Jack.
Well, no, that's what I've looked at. I've worked hard up here, and work tells wherever you are, so I intend to turn to and come out all right, one way or another. I've broken the ice at last.
The dear fellow.
I hope you'll keep away.
Well, I'm sure I wish you every success.
Of course, in time, I shall be all right, but the question is, will you wait?
Wait? What for?
Beg your pardon, I didn't mean that.
Oh, you didn't mean it?
What I'm trying to say is that I would like you to understand what it is I am trying to say.
Yes. What was that?
Well, to be fair and lay everything before you, my position in life will be something in,
the city.
Yes, thank you. My home.
Suburban.
Yes, my transit.
Bustle rail.
My personal income.
Small.
My extra income.
Precarious.
But under certain conditions, my fears would be nil and my hopes tremendous. And now, Kitty, now you know all, and that's where I stand.
Oh, that's how you stand.
Kitty. It's my duty to tell her all.
The dear fellow.
I'll kill anyone who comes now.
Well, I hope those happy conditions will be realized at your heart's content.
Kitty, my dear Kitty, they will never be met or realized without you.
Without me?
Well, now you've vexed me. You hate the city. You despise the suburbs. You loathe buses.
Why should you say that, Jack?
Kitty.
As if I hadn't the heart to do what thousands of better girls than I have done.
Kitty?
As if I couldn't realize that all of the happy fun has to be got out of cooking and mending, administering to the ones in happiness for the man who will work and strive for the woman that he loves.
Then, Kitty.
Try me, Jack, for I love you dearly.
You do, Kitty, you do.
As much as you love me, Jack.
Well, then, Kitty.
My dear Kitty.
My dear Kitty, you're a brick. I've done it. I've done it at last, despite the lot of them.
But what about my guardian, Mr. Spedicue?
I'll see to him at once.
No, that won't do.
Won't do? Why?
No, his consent must be in writing.
In writing? Why?
So that he can retract. You don't know him as well as I do, and there's only one person who can get that written consent for us. So be a good boy and send it to me at once.
Who, Amy?
No, Donna Lucia, Charlie's aunt.
Donna Lucia?
No, don't ask questions. There's a good boy. Send it to me at once, and I'll find Amy.
Oh, what have I done?
Jack, I've done it. I've done it.
Done what?
I let the cat out of the bag, and I told her everything.
Told her what?
That I love her.
Ah, is that all?
Yes, but she's gone off to find Donna Lucia to get her uncle's consent. She'll be in a mess, but Dickens are a mess yet.
Goodness, what would you do?
I'm half crazy, all for my love of you. It won't be a stylish marriage unless
Donna Lucia supplies the carriage. As all look sweet upon the seat of our bicycle built.
You'll drag us into awful disgrace.
And a damn good job, too. You don't know the things he keeps on saying to me.
He who?
Why, my mash, old Spedicute.
What does he say?
Yes, what does he say?
Charlie's too young.
Don't get out, man. That's nothing.
No, but it's very embarrassing. Hey, look at how well I get on with the girl.
Yes. Confound you too well.
Oh, do I?
Jack, I can live with this lie no longer.
Now don't start that. Some lies have got to be lived.
What for?
To save confessing them, you duffer.
I wish to goodness you'd bring it all to an end.
Me too. I want a drink.
We'd be all right if only the donkey would behave like a lady.
Yes, I know all that, but he... can't. He obviously doesn't know how.
As it is, the selfish idiot's ruining everything.
Oh. We were fools to trust him.
Oh, I'll kill the little monkey.
We should have gotten Freddie Peel.
At any rate, Freddie Peel would have stood by us like a man.
When you think of all the misery he's put us to.
You know what? I feel so infernally indignant, I could wring his head off.
Oh, look! Look at him now!
Ah, Mr. Chesney, have you seen Donna Lucia?
In the garden!
Go and get him! Do you get out here?
And now we want you to get his consent, but with mine being a legal affair, You understand, don't you?
Your father's will, you mean?
Yes, and his consent must be in writing.
In writing?
Yes, and you must get it.
Get it?
Yes, you must make him write a letter or something.
Oh, but my dears, I've no influence over him.
Oh, but you are so clever and so kind.
He's so rich.
Oh, yes, so rich. I remember I gave away half a crown only this morning.
At any rate, you must try.
Oh, dear Donna Lucia, do say you will try.
We are going away.
Oh, no, darlings, don't leave me.
Yes, we're going to Scotland.
Scotland, I know, a beautiful country. Where the whiskey comes from.
And you are our only hope.
Oh, Donna Lucia, have you ever been in love?
Oh, yes. Dozens of times. I mean, once in love, always in love, you know?
Then you must know what it means to us, don't you?
And oh. You'll get that written consent for us,
well,
won't you?
Well, I will do my best.
You can't say no now.
No, not now.
Then we'll find Mr. Sped at you and send him to you at once.
Well, here's a real deuce of a mess. Brassett, get me a brandy and soda. Never mind, old Sped keeps coming.
There you are, Donna Lucia. I have been looking for you all afternoon. I have so much to say to you.
Mr. Sped, you? Would you introduce me to...
How annoying. Why couldn't she have kept away? Certainly. Donna Lucia, Mrs. Buttercup Smith, Donna Lucia de Alvadoras.
Oh, how do you do? I'm Charley, from Brazil.
Where the nuts come from?
How do you do? Do you know I'm most interested in meeting you?
Really?
Yes. I knew your late husband. Intimately.
What was the matter, Babs?
She knew my late husband.
Intimately.
How did you get one of these all right, did it?
No. She knew my late husband. Intimately.
Look out, Miss T.
But what of it?
You must entertain it. Donna Lucia, will you pour out tea?
Oh, certainly.
Cruel interruption. My word, getting along so nicely.
Do we all take tea?
You haven't been in England very long, have you? You're making a mess.
Change the subject.
I mean, change the subject.
Do you take sugar and cream?
No, do you take sugar and cream?
Ask her if she takes sugar and cream.
Ask her if she takes sugar and cream.
You know, Donna Lucia, I would like to have a little sugar and cream.
My hat. I beg your pardon.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Stop it.
must keep her in the humor, but I must see her alone. I have it. They must come to dinner. After dinner, that's the time for my purpose. Pardon me, but I have a proposition to make.
Here, you sit down!
Can't take no.
Mr. Spethew's carriage.
Capital, the very thing. Now, I want you, all of you, to come and stay and dine at my house. You'll return with me in the carriage now, Donna Lucille?
I can't. It's impossible.
I will take no denial. I want you, all of you, to come.
I have my niece with me, Miss Delahaye.
Miss Delahaye?
Bring her. Delighted.
No, I can't. My things. No.
That voice? It is.
Tonight to butler for him. I suppose he's too cheap to have a butler of his own. Well, all I can say is it's simply marvelous the way his lordship has kept it up. He's played the perfect lady, something wonderful. Hello, what's up now?
Well, just in case the worst comes to the worst, I've got his lordship's dress clothes with me.
I said, Brat! Get me a fly quick, I'm going home! Oh! Oh.
What are you doing? Why did somebody take off catching on the you? Why did you go over the dinner table like that?
It's awfully dangerous and unkind of you.
Instead of behaving in a dignified manner as Charlie's aunt, here you are going on like some old.
Oh, go on, finish it!
Don't spare me.
You can't say I'm drunk anyhow, for if I am, it's for the want of.
Look, Babs, this game won't do.
Yes, think of the girls and the solemn promise you gave to help us, for their sakes.
Yes, but she wasn't here then.
She who?
The little girl.
What little girl?
Miss Delahaye.
What, you mean the girl Mrs. What's-her-name Smythe?
Yes, Mrs. Butterscotch Smythe's niece.
Well, what of her?
She's the little girl I met at Monte Carlo, and this Butterscotch woman is the woman who took her away, and I'm off!
Stop, Johnny, quick! Oh. You got us in this deuce of a mess!
Well, of all the beastly and grateful things to say!
What difference does it make to you now?
Why, I want to talk to her.
Talk to her? What about?
I want to tell her what you fellows have been telling your girls. Hang it, I'm just as much in love as you are.
Jack, you'll hear everything.
Was there ever such an idiot?
No, there never was. Look at me. I'm a disgrace to my own sex.
If the worst comes to the worst, we take the bull by the horns and be done with it.
You can take the bull by the tail for all I care. And what's more, you can tell those confounded girls to lay off kissing me before her. I won't stand it!
Don't shout, you idiot! We'll butt them up on a fly, have them be off, and tell the girls that she fell ill.
And Charlie, you can make some excuse to Miss Virgin for me.
Miss Virgin? What have you got to say to Miss Virgin?
Haven't I promised to get old Spedigew's consent in writing, you idiot? You two are as helpless as a couple of babies. You want your mothers with you.
Right. This way, madam.
Sit down.
How's your aunt, Mr. Wickham? We were afraid she might be ill.
Yes, is there anything the matter?
No. Auntie's a little upset by the heat of the dining room, that's all.
The heat? I found it rather cold.
Oh, yes, that's what Charlie meant, cold. You see, Donna Lucia is from a very warm climate.
Oh, you must try some of Auntie's smelling salts. They're so good.
Thank you. She's often like this, isn't she, Charlie?
I hope Donna Lucia is all right.
Yes, is she? Oh, yes. Mr. Chesney says she is all right now.
Oh, then send for Mr. Spedding. You?
Of course.
And leave her here with us. Yes, we will look after her now.
Oh, I say, you fellows, don't leave me like this.
Here's a real deuce of a position. I wonder what they'll talk about. I hope they'll be careful before me.
some old thing they got after receiving my telegram.
Did you say something to her, Auntie? I'd like to hear her talk.
I would, my dear, but look at her. If I thought they really meant for that to be like me, I would never forgive them.
Hark at the silly fools. I said, Brassett, what's the story?
The gentlemen seem to be enjoying themselves.
Oh, yes, they do indeed.
Yes, don't they?
Do you know, that reminds me of a very funny story.
Just what I expected.
That Dom Pedro was very fond of telling.
I must put a stop to this. Won't one of the young ladies play something, please?
How rude of her to interrupt.
She couldn't have heard you, Auntie.
Oh, do tell us the story, Miss Beverly Smythe.
Yes, anything about Don Pedro would be so interesting. Do tell us.
But perhaps Donna Lucia would prefer to tell Don Pedro's story herself.
Tom Pedro?
No, no, no. Your late husband, you know. Don Pedro Dalvadoris.
Oh, yes. Certainly. I remember the names, but I don't remember his stories. I don't hold with such frivolity. It's too bad, those fellows.
Auntie, don't tease us so. Tell the story yourself.
All right. Well, Don Pedro, who was the kindest soul in all the world. But will Donna Lucia give me permission?
Oh, you don't mind if Miss Beverly Smythe tells the story, do you?
And you'll listen, won't you?
Well, if I must, I must.
Well, as I was saying, Don Pedro, who was the kindest soul in all the world, once found one of his cellarmen tipsy, very tipsy.
Toot, toot!
So, Don Pedro, whom the man did not recognize...
Now, why was Don Pedro tipsy?
No, 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 no. Don Pedro was most abstemious. That's what makes the point of the whole story.
Oh, does it?
Yes. So, Don Pedro said to the man, what would Don Pedro say if he saw you like this?
Tipsy like this?
Yes, yes, tipsy.
And what did the man say?
Well, the man said, and that's where it is so funny.
Oh, is this where we laugh?
No, no.
The man said, that's all right. Don Pedro's often like this.
And silly stories. And then what was the man's name?
Really, I don't know the man's name.
Oh, that's a pity.
But don't you remember the story? It was a favorite one of Don Pedro's.
Yes, perfectly. I shrieked when I heard it first. I say, that reminds me of a very funny story. Won't one of the young ladies play something, please?
I'm so out of practice. You sing something, Amy.
I can't. I know nothing new.
Oh, sing that charming little ballad. Ta-ra-ra-boom-dee.
I'm afraid I can't, Donna Lucia.
But perhaps you would like to sing something for us, Donna Lucia.
Me?
Yes! One of those charming Brazilian ballads I've heard Don Pedro was so fond of.
Oh, no. I haven't sung since I had the measles.
What?
Over 40 years ago.
Another rival. I was the merest infant.
But I play a little. That's a good idea. Shan't have to talk and I can drown out the conversation.
I hope you've quite recovered from the shock my niece gave you today.
Oh, yes, I was a little upset, wasn't I? I suffer so much from giddiness. Were you ever giddy?
Never.
Oh, I was. What shall I play? A little Beethoven or Bluebells of Scotland?
Come along, my dear friends, come along.
Here they come. Now don't forget the letter.
What for it?
Let's take them all out to the garden and leave her alone with Mr. Spedding.
Charming! Bring the cigars, Grasset. Unless the ladies, Mrs. Beverly Smythe, Donna Lucia, do you object to some cigars?
Smoking? Oh no, I like it. It kills the insects and things.
Look at him, Jack. What's he doing? I'm staring at him like he did all through dinner. I'm a fool.
I must make an opportunity to see her alone. Pardon me, it's a sweet evening. Perhaps some of you may care to enjoy a cigar in the garden?
No, thank you.
It's a sweet evening.
You've been enjoying yourself capitally, Miss Vernon. We heard the music.
Yes, Donna Lucia has been playing for us.
Yes, how charming of you, Donna Lucia. What would we have done without your dear aunt, Charley?
Don't throw like that, you idiot.
Are you fond of music, Mrs. Pettigrew?
I hope to be.
What? Are you thinking of taking lessons? What's he looking at me like that for? Like a boiled owl?
I'm glad you know I'm kidding out, Dad.
I like you very much, I must say.
I was beginning to think I was quite without all means.
Oh, not at all. You thought the matter well, Orban?
Yes, Dad, right you did.
It's a serious step, you know. A serious step.
Now don't forget, the letter must be in writing. Let's get them all out into the garden and you take Charley.
Well, I look at that now.
But why won't you listen to reason?
Well, of course I'll listen to reason, but where is the letter?
I remember. I've not written it yet.
Not yet!
We must find an opportunity to talk it over. Alone.
That would be nice.
But, Charley, why are you so depressing? We ought to be very happy today.
Amy, sometimes such great joys come with a sort of reaction. I shall be better. Tomorrow.
Oh, come into the garden.
I told Dad, like, after the, he's delighted, but... You won't forget to your back on society and the world
and the stifling hollowness of my own Monday and everyone else's rest of the week, and to have something real to think about. Jack, the vista is too heavenly. Come out into the garden.
It's a sweet evening. Perhaps you'd like a cigar, Jack?
No, thank you.
It's a sweet evening.
No, thank you.
Shall we join them?
Yes. It's a charity to leave those two alone.
Indeed. Why?
Only a little matchmaking mischief, that's all.
What, spectacular's account?
No, on Donna Lucia's.
They've gone. Lucia.
At it again!
I need to speak with you.
No! I am very angry with you.
Oh, you wound me, don't say that.
But I do say, after the promise you made me to treat me like this.
Promise?
The consent you promised in writing.
Oh, Lucy, how can you when we have so much to say that more nearly concerns ourselves?
No, we have not! You don't know me. I am no ordinary woman.
I'm begging you to listen to me.
I will listen to you with pleasure, but where's the letter you promised me?
Will you hear me, Lucia?
I will hear you with pleasure, but why won't you give me the letter?
Oh, Lucia, do I deserve this?
He deserves 6 months, the old idiot.
Lucia, you are a puzzle, an enigma.
How rude! Till you give me the letter, all is over between us.
Oh, Lucia, that decides me. I go to my room, a brief note.
With full consent and sign, don't forget.
Then say you'll be mine.
I'll say anything you like. Don't be too long in the study.
Darling,
Now that's all right. I say, what devils we women are. Too bad for those fellows. I should be an old woman for the rest of my life. I haven't had a drink or a smoke all day. Here's a find. I wonder how long he'll be. Hanged if I don't chance it. Just beautiful.
She's smoking.
Did you find the chili?
Yes, my dear. I thought I'd get a wrap of some kind.
No, I'll go upstairs and get you something. I know what you think of.
Thank you, my dear.
Are you alone?
Oh, yes, I'm all alone and so sad.
What a dreadful smell of smoke.
I know, I noticed it myself. I'll go find out who it is.
No, no, don't go. I wanted to talk to you.
Really?
About your late husband, Dom Pedro Dalmadores.
Oh, that would be nice.
Do you know when I met Dom Pedro, he told me he had no wife.
Ah, the wicked storyteller. Ah, but he was a cruel husband.
The Dom Pedro I knew was noble, kind, and gentle.
That was his father, the old gentleman with the white mustache.
I never knew such effrontery. Donna Lucia, I'm surprised you haven't taken up the habit of smoking. So many Brazilian women do, you know.
Well, to tell you the truth, that's exactly what I was doing when you walked in.
Then pray don't let me interrupt you. I shouldn't have been surprised at a pipe.
May I offer you one?
No, thank you. Not being a Brazilian lady, it might be thought rather strange.
Will you have a drink of any kind?
No, thanks. Donna Lucia, pardon my asking, but have you any children?
Only a few. None to speak of.
Is your wrap for me?
Oh, thank you, my dear. I am going to go into the garden. I fancy Sir Francis has something to say to me. And since it's so chilly, perhaps you better stay in.
Auntie says we're not to hint about her knowing that she's not Auntie. Sure, she's only doing it to oblige them.
Oh, there you go. Please.
I was only going into the garden.
It's turned quite chilly. Auntie has sent me in the passage.
Can I get you a wrap of any kind?
Yeah, thank you. Auntie thinks I'm better here. I've been ill, you know.
Oh, but I didn't know.
Oh, I'm all right now, of course. I take care.
Oh, yes. You must take great care.
But Auntie, I fancy it more particular than usual this evening, for, you know, she and Sir Francis were sweethearts.
Were they?
Telling her that he was ever and ever so fond of her. Auntie says he was shy and went away without knowing that she was ever and ever so fond of him. The noblest man I knew was kind and oh so shy. He got to know how Papa had become so poor and so ill. Lost a lot of money to him at cards. I often wondered why they played cards. But when I asked the doctor if it wasn't doing any harm, he said, not the game being played. But if all the money, I believe, meet, I wish to give it back.
Oh, no, you must never think of doing that. It would be like accusing him of a sort of cheating, you know?
But it was so much. Enough, Auntie thinks, to make me independent for life.
And do you think he would take it back if he knew that?
But I should feel it's my duty.
Well, it's too late now.
But he went away before I had time to tell him how much I loved him for his kindness to my poor father. You don't mind my telling you all this, do you? I don't know why, but I like to talk to you. I like you. And I just so wish to see him again.
Have you got the letter?
Yes, here's the letter, but first, make my happiness complete. Say from this blissful moment we are engaged.
We are engaged. Got it! We are engaged.
Darling.
Mr. Spinnegue!
Oh, call me Stephen.
Is this the letter, Stephen?
Yes, that is the letter, and we are betrothed.
We are betrothed, darling!
Ah, Mrs. Beverly Smythe, Sir Francis, congratulate me, congratulate me!
I knew it.
I'm the happiest man in the world, but where are the dear children? This is a day of happiness and rejoicing for us all. For us all!
What on earth does he mean? What's all this excitement about?
Can't you guess?
No.
Didn't I tell you what would happen if we left them alone?
Eh?
Don't you understand? She's accepted him.
What?
Donna Lucia Dalvadorez.
You don't mean that.
I fancy he'll find out his mistake before too long.
By George, what a fool I've been.
Why, are you sorry?
No, but that rascal boy of mine made some stupid suggestion that I should...
That you should offer your hand and your heart to Donna Lucia Dalvadorez from Brazil, where the nuts come from.
When I think what a fool I was, might have been, should have been.
Why? Do you envy him?
No, I don't envy him.
But think of her millions.
Ah, Lucy. When I saw your face...
You didn't recognize it.
No, but when I did... But I told you all that in the garden just now. And you'll be content for a while with a cottage and your old sweetheart.
And you? You would take me, a penniless widow.
Nothing would make me happier.
Frank!
Lucy! Why, what are you smiling at?
Oh, I was just thinking...
About what?
About Donna Lucia Dalvadorez.
Well, she's a quaint little figure, I must own.
Mm-hmm. Auntie, did you find the egg chili?
I didn't notice, my love.
Auntie, how pretty you look tonight. Has Sir Francis.
Come along, my dear children, come along. Now, Kitty, you sit there, Amy there. I have something to tell you. Something that you'll all be very pleased to hear. But, where's Donna Lucia?
I fancy Donna Lucia's gone to her room, sir.
Perhaps just as well. Now, before she returns, I have a secret to tell you.
A secret? Really?
Pardon me if I ask your attention for a few moments.
Goodness gracious, Jack, what's he going to say?
How do I know? Please say it.
Situated as I am, a lonely widower, a mateless uncle, surrounded by grave responsibilities, my ward, my niece, a good fairy has, I may say, tripped in among us, bringing with her unexpected light and joy.
Who's he talking about?
Shut up.
Under her influence, I have consented to the engagement of my niece to a gentleman whose honor and probity I have the fullest confidence, Mr. Charles Wickham.
Charlie, how sweet of you, dear Hans.
Furthermore, charmed by irresistible spells, I have consented to the union of my ward with John, only son of my friend, Sir Francis Jesmond. Sir Francis, what would you say to a third engagement.
Another?
This woman, whose name is honored in the southwestern hemisphere as that of Rothschilders in Europe, she has consented to become Mrs. Stephen Spettigue. I allude to our dear friend, Donna Lucia Diabadoras. What was that?
I beg your pardon, sir. The tray, sir.
Be more careful, Brass.
Uncle!
Be more careful. Now, nothing could please me more than...
Mr. Spettigue, I can listen to this ghastly farrago no longer.
Mr. Wickham, sir, what do you mean?
I say, sir, and I don't care what the result may be. I can listen to this ghastly...
I presume in espousing my niece.
Oh, I can't. I won't espouse her. Not under these false and lying pretenses.
Do you allude in such a manner?
Now listen to me. That woman...
I beg of you to speak with more respect of your aunt.
She is not my aunt.
Not your aunt? What do you mean?
I love Amy far too sincerely.
I don't want to hear that. Explain your words.
Mrs. Spettigue, if you allow me to explain, I would tell you everything.
I'm addressing this person now. Answer me, sir. Explain your words.
I must inform his lordship of this.
At the last moment this morning, my aunt, on whose account we invited Miss Spettigue and Miss Verdon, telegraphed to say that she couldn't come. The ladies arrived, and we...
And I prevailed upon someone...
to impersonate her. Ooh, I've been treacherously, infamously deceived.
That was not our intention, sir.
Oh, don't lie to me, sir.
You forget, sir. You were not expected.
Oh, in a frump like that. With a wig?
Well, you can't blame her for that.
Oh, turn that woman out of my house.
I say, here, come in!
Turn that woman out of... Who are you, sir?
I'm Charlie's aunt, from Brazil. Where the nuts come from.
Fanport family, you duffer!
Fanport family, I beg your pardon.
Auntie and I told him everything.
What does this mean, sir?
It means that we've all done... very wrong. We're all extremely sorry and tender you our humblest apologies. My apologies, I should say, for if I had not offered the temptation... the whole thing would never have occurred.
This is infamous. Infamous! But, where's that document that was obtained for me under these fraudulent pretenses?
The letter? Well, I have the letter.
Give it to me.
It's mine!
Sir, I demand it.
No.
Allow me.
I shall dispute it under her father's will. I shall dispute it.
This letter is addressed to and has been delivered to Donna Lucia Dalvadorez.
But she, I mean he... That is not Donna Lucia Diavadoras.
No, but I am.
You? My aunt?
You? You will pardon me if I retire. And as for you, sir, I shall inquire from the authorities your college. In the morning.
I say, Charley, can he have me up on breach of promise?
Charley! Mr. Wickham, I mean. How dare you? I'll never forgive you. I'll never forgive any of you for treating Uncle Stephen like that.
Be patient with us, my dear. Your uncle shall have the most profound reparations my influence can make. As for my role in the deception, It only became necessary when I arrived and found another lady established in my place.
No wonder she knew all about my late husband.
Or is anyone, but I trust Jack with my life.
Really? Then he must wait until I'm his mother.
Now, yes, Donna Lucia. In deceiving me as much as anyone has, however, done me the honor of recollecting an old affection, and has agreed to assume that authority. So look out, Jack.
Lord Fancourt Beverly, I'm afraid you have gained one confidence that nothing could excuse.
I know, and I reproach myself beyond expression. But I wouldn't part with the memory of that confidence to save my life. And if Miss Delahaye will allow me to say so, I will atone for it with a lifelong devotion.
Now, where's my son?
Here, Mama.
I shall have to speak with you very carefully before I ever give you this. Charley, I'll never forgive you if you deceive this sweet girl ever again. And as for you, sir...
Oh, no! Never again. You have my word. You can have the clothes if you'd like, because I'm done with it. Miss Delahaye has consented to think me over as a husband. And in future, I resign to Sir Francis Chesney all claims to Charlie's aunt. Round of applause.
And in turn, I'd like to thank our lighting director, Donnie. Our stage manager, Marisha Kishak. And the two grips that made it all happen, Helena. And she's got one of those hyphens. Asa Kadmeg Hutchnick. And Charlene Fuquay. Thank you all for coming.
Oh,
have a good night.
Oh, forgot the sound man.
Oh,
forgot Tom Thomas Copeland.
Dr. Thomas Copeland on sound. And of course, Sam Luchak on the 50-50. Yeah. Thank you all for coming. We had a great time doing this for you. Good night, everybody.
Thank you.
Come up to the stage.
You can come up to the stage if you like. Yes. We will be here for your photographic opportunities.
Where'd you go? Where'd you go? Take everyone else.
Nice job.